People are still online coming in, so now we are ready to start. If the panel is ready to start, the moderator is ready to start. So, good evening. I'm Councilmember Marcelo Zapata. I would like to welcome all of you to our first East Roswell Economic Development Forum. This is a first forum of many forums that I'm organizing here and other part of the city as well. The next forum, for your information, will be with the community around the historic square. This will be our next forum, so be tuned for that. I would like to thank our panelists and moderator for their effort of being here tonight to help us shape a vision and identity for a sustainable economic development. But this will be, we won't be possible, this event, without the support and contribution from Mr. Jason Sabatino, a very active member of our community with an incredible passion to make our city better and better every day. Thank you, Jason. I would like to thank our elected officials here tonight. I see Council Member Palermo here, Council Member Orton, and Mayor Wood, I saw earlier.
Hello, Marcelo.
And our city staff, thank you very much, our city staff. I know it's late, and we appreciate your time here, and all your contribution to make this forum possible. Before we start our first economic development forum, I would like to invite our elected officials to say, if they want, a few words. I want to make, because, you know, we are politicians, so I just try to say a few words. So I would appreciate if you can come here if you want and say a few words before we start the forum.
Let's have a hand for Marcelo for putting this together.
Well, thank you. And well, the main objective of this forum is for all of us to frame our thoughts in order to, one, understand our current economic and business situation in East Roswell. Two, identify the problems and challenges that we have. Three, learn from similar contexts of the national level, because we are not by ourselves here, you know. That what we're seeing here, the empty retail boxes, is a phenomenon that is across the country, so we're not ourselves here. So we have to see if we can learn from the experience of the national level. And also four, and the most important, is to develop a vision and identity for the future economic development of East Roswell. In order to accomplish the vision and what we need to accomplish, the last point, the existing local community will need to define, we will need to define here in East Roswell what kind of experiences we would like to have nearby our houses. So for this reason, I would like you to focus for a second here on the slide, developing a vision and identity. What we need to do here is to start thinking and creating ideas to generate destination places. Also, we can, you know, contemplate convenient places, and all, a mix of both of them. Just to give you a very simple example of what it is, what I meant with this is, you know, if you put in a restaurant contest, think about, you know, high-end restaurants, they become a destination restaurant. And then you have other McDonald's that they are convenient. So this is what they are in every corner, one, because it's convenient. So we have to determine what we want. We want a destination place, we want a convenience place, or both of them. So this will be supported by, you know, walkability, density, and connectivity. Those are to support the mega idea or vision. Those are not the vision themselves. So what we have to do is develop first what we want, and then we see how walkability, density, or connectivity play a role into the vision we have. So, saying that, I'm just trying to frame, you know, the thoughts here. So now, let me introduce you, Council Member Mike Palermo, our community development liaison, who is going to say a few words, and we start officially our first economic development forum. Thank you very much for coming tonight.
Councilmember Zapata. Thank you everyone for being here. Just so amazed and impressed to see how many people here. The room is full of seats, and I feel bad that there's so many people needing to stand. Technically, I do see two or three seats here and one seat there, one there. So we've got four seats, about 100 people standing. So I do apologize. Thank you for everybody that's already sitting on the ground. Please get comfortable. This is a very important, valuable conversation. Before we get into it, I actually do want to just I want to show a little respect to show a lot of respect to. We have some individuals here running for public office. This is by no means a political event. This is a crucial economic development event. But just because it takes so much guts to get in front of everybody, I just want to give everyone a chance to just very quickly stand up and yell out their name if they're running, just as a little bit of, just do it, because again, I appreciate everybody coming here. Again, I know it takes a lot of guts to want to get in front of everybody. Thank you.
And my name's Michael Litton, and I'm running for mayor. Michael for mayor, Litton listens, Litton leads.
A little early for that, but again, everybody here in this room, whether running or not, really loves their home, loves Roswell, and it's such an important evening. And I'm really excited for tonight's conversation. This has taken a lot of work, a lot of time, a lot of preparation. So this is something that absolutely has been really thought out, and wanting to use this opportunity to really get us all together, because the stakeholders are not just the individuals at City Hall, and obviously I'm one of those multiple individuals at City Hall. Those are not the only stakeholders. The stakeholders are everybody in this room. So let's make sure that we really are getting an open, honest dialogue. And with that, what I want to just really encourage is a chance to really think outside the box and think with a different approach. A lot of you might come in here with a preconceived notion of one thing, or perhaps another one of you has heard a certain thing a lot. And I encourage us to all really come and think about what really is best for our community, both from an economic development standpoint, as well as the community that we want to live in, because that balance is crucial. We can't just look at either side or one side. It's crucial that we all are proud of where we live. And again, that's what I think tonight is going to be. And so impressed by the panelists, because again, a lot of us that you typically hear from City Hall, you can hear from a lot, but I think it's so crucial that we have true experts here that are going to really just talk about some different points before we open into a very interactive Q&A. So really,
is your mic on? We can hardly hear you in the back.
I will speak into it a little more. Yeah. I appreciate that, and that will be important information for Mr. Levine. So moderating the event will be Michael Levine, East Roswell resident and business co-owner with his wife Tracy. Mr. Levine is a co-founder, president, and managing director of Executive Search for Advantage Talent Incorporated. He has also been a featured speaker and trainer for many corporations and professional groups with focus on improvement of operational effectiveness and profit. Everyone that was out, I think there were only 250 copies, so I'm not sure everyone had a chance to get one, but there's a more detailed bio on there where, again, Michael Levine could not be more excited to get to have you moderate this conversation. And please make sure to speak into the mic.
Thank you. I'm going to try something technical to pull this out just to make sure. All right, it works. Thanks everybody for coming out this evening. Okay, thank you. And can somebody go like this if they can't hear me? Okay, how about now? Is that any better at all? Okay, good. All right. Good. I'll try not to lick the mic. All right, so we have great panelists this evening. Thank you all for coming out. I think this is going to be a really interesting conversation. So what I'd like to do is introduce each of the panelists and give them an opportunity to summarize why they're here, and then we'll give each of them an opportunity to share what it is that is key importance to them and how it's relevant to us. The key to this evening, having a successful evening, is making sure that it is relevant. So the panelists are committed to that, and hopefully we're all committed to relevance this evening. So with that, we'll get started. Our first panelist, Steve Stroud, lifelong resident of Roswell, executive director of Roswell, Inc., which promotes economic development through public and private partnership with the city of Roswell. focus on expanding opportunity zones and increasing the number of certified businesses, launching networking, educational, informative programs to assist and retain local businesses, and forging open communication between all parties in this room. Steve?
Thank you, Michael. Longtime friend. It's good to be in East Roswell. It's good to be in Roswell. I'm a 40-plus year veteran and Roswell resident. I grew up here and went to Crestwood High School. I remember the three-way stop at Holcomb Bridge in Old Alabama. So I remember that vividly. I remember the Magic Market and the 7-Eleven were the highlights of our day to come down Old Alabama or go to see my friends. I remember those days when we actually went to the river and hung out. And Stan Moses, my principal, we drank beer on the river. Those were the days. Things have changed a lot, and I'm fortunate. We all are fortunate. We've seen a lot of change and a lot of positive change. But now is a time where I'm raising my three girls here in the city of Roswell. I'm a Roswell resident, and I continue to say we're in a changing environment, and today is one of those days. We have to be in this environment, so we need to figure out what kind of environment, as Councilman Zapata said, we are in. What are we going to accept? So my role at Roswell, Inc. is to be a moderator between business and community, to build businesses, but also bring in quality jobs that we can sustain our community so that the retails and the business owners can sustain within the city of Roswell, and that's our role.
Thanks, David. Next panelist is Dr. Joseph Hacker, Clinical Assistant Professor, Undergraduate Program Director in Public Management and Policy at the Andrew Young School of Policy Studies at Georgia State University. That's a mouthful. His focus is planning and economic development, significant experience as manager of transit, bicycle and pedestrian planning and coordinated human services. And these memberships include Transportation Research Board, American Institute of Certified Planners. He serves on the Transportation Cooperative Research Program, among others. Dr. Joseph?
Hello. Thank you for having me in Roswell. That's quite an introduction, probably more than took all my material. I'm here, I spent 25 years in Philadelphia doing in the public sector, doing transportation and land use planning. I returned to Atlanta after these 25 years and see how much it's changed. And what I see is I certainly see the links between transportation and land use. I work in other communities in the region on economic development issues, and I'm telling you that a lot of your issues are shared all over the region. And I think that as we begin to talk about solutions and as we begin to ask the right questions about what we want and what we want to become, I believe that a lot of these will settle out, and that we will find that there is a prosperous and I think a whole future for everyone in Roswell and beyond.
Thank you. Next panelist, Paul Hirschberg, East Roswell business owner, East Roswell preschool, and real estate investor, longtime Roswell resident with a focus on working with children and revitalizing and redeveloping commercial property.
I'm probably the only guy without a degree up here, you know. I'm just one of you that came up here and got volunteered. So anyway, I've lived in East Roswell since 94. I've lived in East Roswell since 94, and I've spent the last 10 years taking a preschool that was in trouble and fixing it. That's in the Horseshoe Bend community. And I've also bought a strip mall that's in that area and also revitalized it. So I've had some experience up and down the area. I really enjoy East Roswell. I like East Roswell, but I think East Roswell doesn't have a hub. Doesn't really have a central point. I think it needs that. I've kind of watched it, you know, since 94 when I've been here, and I struggled with an empty strip mall for 3 years trying to find tenants, national tenants, and nobody would come in, and other box retailers would come in. And East Roswell has its own set of you know, things that make it hard to develop and hard to do things with. So when they came to me and asked me to volunteer to speak up, I told them I would speak up with my own experiences and having lived in Horseshoe Bend and having tried to develop some property around here and trying to turn around a location and seeing empty strip malls trying to be taken care of. I've seen how frustrating it is and what it takes to do it. So I told them I would volunteer to kind of help and come up with some new ideas, just being one of you guys and being a resident here, but also want to do something for the area. When I describe East Roswell, everybody asks me what it is, and all I can tell them is it's a studio movie grill here. You know, I have nothing else to tell them. I say, when I advertise for employees, I say, Dunwoody, Norcross, Alpharetta, and Roswell. Because when I tell them East Roswell, they don't know where that is. I can't even remember that. So I think we need to have a hub and be known for something and have it be a village or something of substance.
Thanks, Paul. Thank you, Paul. And next panelist, David McNair, Director of Laboratory Development, Woodruff School, manages junior and senior level laboratories in mechanical engineering. He develops innovative laboratory experiences focusing on building an ecosystem to allow universities to collaborate to achieve effective undergraduate laboratory experiences. He's co-founder and board member of Southwest Maker Alliance, director of Maker Faire Atlanta, and he has a significant focus on investment in K through 12 education.
Thank you. Again, I think you stole everything that I was going to say here. So what I'm here for is mainly how do we have a conversation that's around culture, and then I'd like to bring a couple of options, mainly from work that I've done in the Maker movement, ways of interfacing with K through 12, with school systems that we have in the local area. How can we have a community that really values education, values things that get us all engaged together, whether we're artists, whether we're engineers, whether we're technology people, a way to bring us all to a certain city center to communicate with each other, work with each other, mentor each other, and then to expand from that as a way of really building out a city center that we all want to be a part of.
Thank you very much. Okay, so the introductions are complete. Now, if each of you could share with us for about 5 minutes the key points that you'd like for each of us to understand, what's most important to you in your respective roles, and how we can benefit as we move forward. Steve, if you want to get started.
Thanks, Michael. I think it's important we remember that less than 10 years ago, we were in a recession, a major recession that hit most of us at our biggest investment, which is our home. I know it did to our home on the west side of Roswell. I know it did to many of you, most of us. We've come out of that. We've started to finally see our home values increase in the city of Roswell. Traditionally, the city of Roswell for the last 45 years has been a bedroom community of C-level corporate folks. When I was jokingly talking about Martin's Landing and going down on the flats and then the rocks, the reality was most of those friends of mine moved into this area with IBM or Georgia Pacific or Coca-Cola. And they moved up here. They moved here because we all wanted a quality of life. My parents and I was fortunate. I was a JCPenney brat. I followed my dad from Indianapolis, from Denver to Indianapolis to Louisville to Atlanta. And we're here because we love this quality of life. We love this. My parents are still here. And our role today is to make sure that we continue to look at why are we here, what do we want to be, and where do we want to be for our grandkids and our children. And what we see here in Roswell is this great community. We don't want to be somebody of someplace else. But what we do have to do is look at the reality. The reality is we're in a changing environment. Retail, for example, doesn't work. Councilman Zapata said density. It's been a tough word for the city of Roswell to swallow, but we know it's working in other areas. I'm not here to suggest that that's an answer, but we have to look at all the possibilities. Our role at Roswell Inc. is to make sure that we bring in the right developers, because what we're not doing is developing, we're redeveloping. Roswell is totally in a redevelopment mode. It's taking old abandoned shopping centers, which we too often forget, are owned by Target and Kohl's themselves. We also know that sometimes it's in the recession, it was much more economical for those owners to leave those buildings empty than it was to lease them out. We forget that it's not as easy as just saying, well, we want to replace that old Publix at the corner of Highway 9 and Hope and Bridge Road, when Publix Corporation has a 20-year lease on that piece of property and pays rent every month. See, it just doesn't become as easy as I used to say, well, why don't we just tear that building down? Why don't we just find a tenant? Because for 30 years, I was in the printing business in this city. I developed my own building. I built my own building. I went through the the pain and agony of going through the process, and I understand what that's like. I understand what Paul does every day. I've had to make payroll at the end of the week. We have a very unique situation in the city of Roswell. We don't have corporate campuses. We have a few. We have a Kimberly Clark. It's been a good corporate citizen. Sits on 90 acres behind a wall of trees. That adds 1,400 employees to our payrolls that shop and then eat at McAllister's at lunch. Our role is to continue to find those kind of good employers. But we don't have large areas to put corporate campuses. What we have is entrepreneurs in City Roswell. We have over 5,400 business licenses. Two-thirds of those are entrepreneurs, small businesses, less than 10 employees. Those are you and I. Those are the people that work out of their home. Those are the people that work in these small offices. But we also have a lot of employees, residents that live in this community that leave every day to go to Duluth, to go to Swanee, to go to Buckhead, to go to Midtown, to go to the Perimeter. What if we were able to capture some of the ideas that we're going to talk about tonight? Again, it starts with ideas. Capture those people and allow them to work here, to drive 5 minutes from Horseshoe Bend to their office, to leave their office on the third or fourth floor and go downstairs and have a bagel, to have lunch, to pick up their groceries and come home in 10 minutes, or make a tea time at 6 o'clock. What if? So we need to look at what those are. Councilman Zapata has challenged us, and I think it's important. Those developers are out there, I can tell you. They knock at our door and we talk to them. But they want the community to be united on what they want. They're not in a position to fight. They want to be welcomed. And these are national organizations that look at us because we do have the quality of life. We do have the home values. We do have the education. We have a hospital of 218 beds that most communities don't have. We have 1,000 acres of parkland most communities don't have. We have a riverfront that most communities don't have. We need to take these assets that we have on the east and the west and combine that. And how do we better situate East Roswell to be all of Roswell, to be a destination? And that's our role.
Thank you, Steve.
Again, thank you. I'm here, I want to provide some context. I want to provide some ideas regarding best practices in the planning profession. And I want to raise some questions, which I think hopefully will stimulate questions to follow. First of all, in terms of context, we want to know what's going on. Steve, you already related to the recession, but also what we're seeing is change in the markets. Traditional mall anchors are fading away. Retailers like Kohl's, Target, Sears, JCPenney, they're shrinking. They're seeing their market share go away, but what's happening is they're shrinking along with the middle class. So what's a response to that? In some cases, we decide to upgrade. We decide to go with luxury malls. We see in some places luxury is what sells. You can see that in attempts over in Alfreda and Avalon. One other response is something I call right-sizing. Target, one of the things they're doing is shifting away from big boxes to small focus stores that are focused on the local economy. So if you were somewhere in rural Wisconsin, you could find night crawlers and some camo. Roswell, I think, would have a little different profile. One of the things we see with something like that, you know, when we talk about these retailers going away, Walmart, one of the biggest employers across the United States, still closing 154 stores nationwide. So this is affecting all the businesses. We also see the rise of e-commerce. You know, why leave home if you can just click on things in your pajamas? And one of the things I challenge Roswell to think about is what's the reason to come out here? Give us a reason. Other thing I want to mention in terms of context, has to do with, again, something I mentioned a minute ago, business transition and right-sizing. What we're seeing is stores too large for the trade areas they're in. On my way up here, I stopped in Chick-fil-A and I overheard some woman saying what a sad day it was that the Target had closed, her favorite Target had closed. And knowing that there's Targets, three other Targets within a couple of miles of here, but the truth is Target closed because there wasn't enough business. You have to start thinking ahead as to the size of the businesses you want. I know of a case in Howell Mill part of Atlanta, and what they did was they bargained with Walmart, so they put their store in an existing mall already. What happened was the concern is not that Walmart would come and go, but that Walmart would come, build a store, and then leave the community with the store. These are the kind of things we want to look ahead for. Right, the other thing I think we want to think about is like something to do with the character of the neighborhood. And some of the best practices involve keeping the downtowns vibrant and keeping those 1,000 acres of forest undeveloped. How do we compete with e-commerce? Again, we need a reason to go out, an activity requiring interaction, whatever that is. We want to know what the demand is, not what we need, but what do people want? What are people willing to go out and spend their money on? What are people willing to get in their car and brave the traffic and spend their money on? We're looking at destinations, the idea of attracting people from around the region. I know that I've done some work over in Alpharetta, and one of the things they say over there is that they want to become the downtown for the suburbs. I don't know if that's true, if that's going to happen or not, but certainly they're trying to become a destination. But also, we don't want to leave out the people that live here. We want to generate local attraction, things that are going to enhance your lives, things that you can go to, things that you can enjoy without having to be especially wealthy of that sort. What we need to do is decide as a community what we want to be. We want to embrace what we are. And I think the future kind of comes in two parts. One is what we're doing here, the economic end of it. What do we demand? What do we want? And the political, the approval of these kinds of things. We want to attract the right tenant. We've already talked about that. So we have this area we want to redevelop. What kinds of things could we do? Well, let me give you a couple of examples. I have people in Lansdale, Pennsylvania, where I had done some work, and one of the things they had done was they had enhanced the trail network. They decided that activity was how they were going to pitch their lot. And they created all kinds of bike lanes. They connected with the trails around it and with the trees and the parks around it. And so that the downtown became the place where everyone got off their bikes and went to shop. I was thinking of places out near King of Prussia, which is one of the largest malls in the United States outside of Philadelphia. And what they had was an abandoned mall. What did they do with it? I think this is wonderful. They created an indoor adult sports center. What is that? They literally, they used the big center section and they put in climbing walls. They had go-karts. They had the entire mall, and I've done this and I've taken my kids to it many times in the day. Literally, you had a track that would have gone around the circumference of the inside of it. You bring birthday parties. It was the most wonderful thing ever. You would have mini golf, they had laser tag, they had paintball, all within the inside of a mall. I thought it was one of the most unusual reuses of a mall. Also, another example, I just read about this and someone had brought this to my attention, about brewing beer here in Roswell, that you all are the mini Asheville vibe. Now, I don't know if that's what you want to be. I like Asheville myself, but I thought these are the kind of, I know he's going to talk about maker spaces, but this is the kind of thing that could be really attractive. It serves you, because I imagine some of you drink beer, and I imagine it serves people outside the area who also drink beer. Now, I know this isn't what you're interested in, but I know of a community that decided to embrace gentlemen's clubs. They decided that I see the head straight. I know, that's why I said you're not for this. But they decided that they had a large areas that were unused and they could regulate it and it didn't impinge on the downtown particularly, and they let them go. They couldn't be happier, and they couldn't be happier that they're at the edge of town. Right? These are unique destinations. So we come to the last part of what I want to challenge you with, and that is, what do we want? Often we're making the choice here between character and economic development. I think I'd like to propose that we develop with character. And this means, you know, what are we? Who are we? And not just who we are today, but think about that Walmart that wanted to move into Howell Mill. They like scotched them down, so they had to be in this smaller area, knowing that the future, these elected officials wouldn't necessarily be there, but when that mall left, that it wouldn't be left with some big white elephant. We want to know what our resources are. We want to, again, think about who we are. Who is Roswell? I've been away for a long time, and I know they alluded to it already, but it's changed enormously. There used to be a lot more trees out here, I think. We want to know, yeah, there used to be a lot more trees. Is that something we want? Is that what we want to base our thing on? Maybe we do, maybe we don't. It can be worked into things. What are our values? What are our priorities? What's going to happen is you're going to have a number of options, I'm sure, a lot of ideas, a lot of discussion. The hard part's not going to be taking all that down, but putting it in an order that makes sense. And I think I just want to end saying that it seems to me that this is a pretty happening place. And I know that there's a lot of good people out here come to listen, and I appreciate that. But I think you really do have to think about very seriously, what do we want and who are we here in Roswell? Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. I'd like to take care of one administrative detail, and that is that after Paul's finished with his comments, there will be a video presentation that requires some bandwidth. And from what I understand, and I'm not a technologist in this respect, if there are a variety of people that are connected to Wi-Fi, it would potentially suck down the power on what goes to that presentation, and it could create some glitches. So if I could ask that everybody for the next 10-15 minutes kind of turn off their connectivity so that we can have an uninterrupted presentation. Thanks for your support on that. Paul?
My approach will be a little short and sweet and simpler. I'll kind of tell you from my perspective what I've seen work with my businesses and what I've worked on, you know, the last 3 or 4 years. And, you know, a lot of people, when SuperTarget went out, said, we've got to write SuperTarget, we've got to get them to come back. Really, SuperTarget's not coming back. SuperTarget can't make money, so they're not going to be here. And what I learned, and the mayor taught me this a little bit when I was complaining about how I couldn't fill up my strip mall, was that East Roswell is a unique animal. That we're a corridor over here, and we can't get people to swim the river to come shop in our retail. So all we have is from the river north. And why would they go to the SuperTarget here when they go to the one by the mall? So what ends up happening is we have a lot less density and rooftops than you think you would have to support a lot of the businesses, i.e. the reason why big boxes have never made it. We've never had a successful big box in East Roswell since the early 90s. Nothing's ever made it. So, you know, people either have to live near it and have the density to support a business, or they have to drive through it. And most businesses, people don't drive through them. People don't drive through SuperTarget and pull in there and get some milk and keep driving to Stone Mountain. It doesn't really work that way. So it has to be things that work in the community. So I kind of learned, you know, when I chased Goldberg's, I chased Pet Supermarket, I chased Pure Taqueria, all these places I chased to go in the strip mall, I couldn't get any of them to come here no matter what, no matter how much free rent, no matter what it took, because they knew retail-wise it wasn't going to be a viable thing for them. So the reason I ended up with a doggy daycare in a 10,000 strip mall is because there weren't any other doggy daycare. And if you notice now, doggy daycares are going everywhere. You know, they're coming up everywhere. That's the latest thing. It's a new business, and you can't board your dog on the internet. So that's the my things I learned over 3 years of struggling was you got to find something unique that works over here. It's the same kind of thing for Roswell. We've got to find something that's unique. It has to be a destination. And the other discussions I've had with real estate developer friends is that people will drive to the Forum, people will drive to Avalon, people won't drive to East Roswell. There's nothing to drive here for. There's no experience here in East Roswell that you're going to go out and drive for. So we've got to find something that's going to be an experience. It's a destination to get us on the map so people will come over here and use it. You know, there's just nothing here that we can actually attract people for. It could be office condos. You know, the office condos got developed by Horseshoe Bend. got sold in a snap. That worked really well. A lot of us have businesses don't have a place to go for offices. That's one thing that could work. It could be live, work, play. It could be a lot of different things that we don't have over here, but we may have to stomach heavier density or some different things to be able to get it to work over here. But we have to have an engine and have something that's going to be viable on this side. The other thing I always say is, since I've lived in Roswell since the early 90s, we've always been the stepchild of Roswell. You know, when there's dirt in the streets and Hope Bridge Road has trash up and down it, our side doesn't get clean, but the city of Roswell does get clean. And I will send the emails and call, and they're pretty responsive about coming over here, but they don't do it proactively, because when I ask them why isn't cleaned over here, they say because we have the Park Service is in charge of Roswell, but they're not in charge of the state road of Hope Bridge. And so I just think that getting all this group together excites me about it, is people are finally putting a focus on it. If we put some focus, some energy into it, East Roswell can become something. But I think too long we have been a bedroom community, we've gone back and forth to our houses and just forgotten about it and not tried to do something with East Roswell. I think that it's time to do something with it. There are some different things that need to happen, but it needs to have us focusing on it and wanting to do something with it.
Thank you, Paul. David, before you get started, I think Marcelo has some introduction.
Thank you. So yeah, before we jump into Dr. McNeil's concept or idea, I would like to, prepare your mind, what is coming. So it's very innovative, the concept, and I want to, get you in the mind of innovation. So now I would ask us to think what new use will take maximum advantage of not only the existing building structure, but also their parking lots, surrounding infrastructure, and bringing the community together. I see the closing of big retail boxes around the nation as a unique opportunity to reconvert them into real, sustainable, catalytic projects. I will show you now a short video of an empty Walmart that had been reconverted into the library. But I'm not going to show you this because the library, and we have a beautiful one, brand new, excellent library. But I want to show you this to make you think about the potential that an empty structure of a building has. With imagination, with hard work, and good design, you can come with magnificent things inside the already existing structure. You don't have to tear it down, you have to build on. So I think that, but rather to inspire all of you to think outside the box, actually in this case, outside the big retail box. So let's see the video now, thank you.
We were given a Walmart store, about 125,000 square feet of blank space. We realized that it was going to be too expensive to demolish the existing building and build brand new. But it's a very large building. I believe it's the largest library on one floor. Well, that presented some challenges. And so we divided the library up into four quadrants to minimize patron and staff travel distances within the building. We used two primary elements to move people through the building and orient them. The first is a wood screen. It starts right at the building entry and goes up and becomes a ceiling and leads people into all the functional areas of the library. And the wood screen demonstrates one of the primary concepts of the building, which was to have color and pattern and texture derive from the plants and the animals that both live in the McAllen and Valley area, but also move through it each year, migrating from north to south and from south to north. The other axis, denoted by the meandering orange element, crosses the ceiling at the main service point and moves to the west, dividing the children's area and the adult service area, and ends at the teen area. And so within this neutral white box and the quadrants that we divided into, we had these vast areas of basically blank white space. We used bright, colorful elements that mark both service points and functional points within the children's area and within the adult services area to break up the space, but also to adjust the scale for people to use those areas, and also with the color to infuse visual interest that you don't have just with a big white space. One of the other challenges we had with the library in McAllen was to create a building that served a really wide population, and specifically the people that really need the library. many of those citizens are recent immigrants from Mexico, where there is no tradition of public libraries like we are accustomed to here in the United States. And what we did is we worked with the architects to find a prominent location of the Spanish collection. We also make sure that in the signage program, the Spanish books, Spanish collections were identified. And it is working. We are seeing more and more non-traditional Hispanic recent immigrants coming into the library. South Texas, and especially McAllen, is very family friendly. And that carries into our libraries. We realize that our customers should start when they're very young.
And really a fundamental part of the success of the library is that we were able to create places like the children's area that helps young children learn in an inspiring place that draws them to it, that they're excited to go to in a way that McAllen never had. A place for teens where they're safe, where they can go after school, where they can go on the weekends. And again, a place that doesn't exist elsewhere in McAllen. And a place for adult people, adult learners as well, for folks to come learn English, to build their business, to find a job. And to do that in a place that's inspiring, that's beautiful, and where people can come from all walks of life and do a variety of different things to be a part of their community.
Thank you. So, I've been preparing for this, giving a lot of thoughts. I'm preparing for this presentation for weeks and weeks. And I got across this video that, for me, this video is very inspiring. As the last word of this video mentioned, I don't know if you were able to catch, I went over and over several times, they wanted to create, and I quote, a place that is inspiring, beautiful, and where people can go and do a variety of different things to be part of the community. For me, this short sentence was so powerful, and I see, places like Super Target or Kohl's, that they can become something like that. If we use our creativity and imagination, we can develop something like that. For example, let's talk for a minute about redeveloping an empty big retail box into innovation center. An innovation center as a destination place that offers a unique experience with concepts that fit of each other and combine different activities such as social hub for kids, teenagers, adults, and seniors. Business networking ecosystem. Offices inside this building. Open and closed, short and long-term office rental. Maker spaces, local restaurants, cafes, bakeries, and maybe even cooking schools. Rotating exhibition halls. Having inside this building rotating exhibition halls. Small auditorium. We just saw a little picture there on the video. Nothing big, but that the community can use and get something out of that. And even a museum, a museum for the arts and rotating museum, rotating concept for the museum. So those are all different concepts that I want you to think about and process and imagine and visualize. So saying that, I would like now to turn to Dr. Manir, who is going to give you a specific a concept, which is the makerspace, and how this can benefit the whole community and create this sense of community and ecosystem that he's going to explain much better than I do. So, thank you.
Can everybody hear me, by the way? I know these mics can be a little weird. Awesome. So I'm going to try and keep this brief. I am a instructor at Georgia Tech, so sometimes that's hard to do. So please feel free to hurry me along if you're bored on something. One of the big things that I want to do is sort of ask the question, who are we as Roswell? This is one of the big focuses that I see tonight, is we can talk all day about here are all of these different options that we'd like to do, but who are we as Roswell? What I'm trying to present is an option that we could take. Hopefully it's a good option. It's an option I think could be good, but it might not be what we want. And so I'm looking forward to the conversation that we can have about who are we. And then how do we use our culture as a focus when we're trying to do economic development? We're trying to figure out what exactly we want to create in the city center. When we start talking about what do we want to create in the city center, we want to drive it from that question of who are we? And then finally, how do we benefit economic development with all of this? So that first question, who are we? So, fact. Number one, we all love living in Roswell. Does anybody want to throw up their hand and say this is not true? Good luck. So I always want to start from that because we have a lot of conversations about how Roswell's not doing well because we lost the Kohl's. Roswell's not doing well because we lost the Target. Roswell's not doing well because we lost such and such. Roswell is doing very well. We have awesome people here. We have an amazing community. We have a lot of nature. We have a lot of capabilities that we can tap into. And I want to figure out how do we come up with a solution that really reflects who we are and what the strength of our community is. So, how do we use what our culture is to weave into the development of a culture? So, again, focusing on who we are. So, we are professionals, we are hobbyists, we are artists, we are engineers, we are musicians, we are writers, the list goes on. It's hard to list everything that we are as a group and as a city in Roswell, right? As a curiosity, how many people have ever built something out of wood? Yeah, quite a few people, right? How many of people have stretched into the domain of building something using metal? Still a bunch. How many people love working with art or have done something with clay before? How many people doing something in, say, sewing or embroidery, textile? You know, how many people, this is starting to get more into my domain, engineers doing things with something like robotics? Yeah? How many people working kind of in computers and technology? Lots of people. What I'd love to say is we can all come together, we can use these strengths. These are the kinds of things that a lot of companies are really going to want to look for when they're looking at where do they want to settle. We can build a space that focuses on a lot of these strengths and then becomes a draw for our community. So what I would say to all of you, we have this thing called a makerspace, which is we can work in all of these domains. Everybody that raised your hand, you are a maker. You are someone who enjoys making something, who I hope also enjoys teaching people how to do your craft. Enjoys sharing your craft, enjoys showing off what it is that you do. Now, these are just a few of the projects, but the projects that you can do in this type of a space are truly endless. And then we also have exhibition space. So we have something called Maker Faire Atlanta, which I helped direct, purely because we wanted a way for all of these people who are doing amazing things in the community to be able to come out and share with each other, to connect with each other. Now, the challenge that we have is Maker Faire can only happen one time per year, or maybe twice per year, three times per year, but we can't be bringing everybody out every single weekend. So instead, we'd like to create community centers, community spaces where people can come together, they can work together, they can mentor each other. That's what we know as a maker space. It's a place where you can do what you enjoy doing, if you want to. You can also teach somebody about what it is that you do. Or let's say you want to get into another domain, connect with one of those other folks in the room that raised their hand that was in that other domain. That's what the makerspace culture is all about. Now, I can throw up all kinds of quotes that reflect this. There's lots of people all the way from national radio channels, all the way up through the federal government level, all over the place, that essentially is saying makerspaces work. Everybody can be a part of a makerspace, and you can really truly build a community from this. What does it take to build a makerspace? What are the components of this? Think back to that video we just watched. We had a whole lot of talking about different spaces. We had spaces for K-12. We had spaces like an auditorium, something where you can really come in. You can learn from one another. You can have programming there. Maybe you could have some up-and-coming musician that wants to come in and they want to use that space. You want to have some space for design and collaboration. This is space that has a whole bunch of whiteboards. This is the kind of place that someone who wants to really start up and do entrepreneurship, wants to have a startup business. They need a lot of this sort of space, and they need the ability to work with others, to generate ideas, to brainstorm. That's what's really going to build a vibrant community. Now, we also need some prototyping space. We need some fabrication space. Think of these as all of the tools you wish you could have, but are probably too expensive to put in your own basement or in your own garage. Right? We can come together, we can create a space that houses a lot of these tools, and oh, by the way, a lot of those companies that want to come in and they want to innovate, rapidly innovate, build an innovation center, they also want to have access to those same tools. So we can start leveraging that as a way to even make this space viable. We can have the space essentially paying it for itself through offering these tools to businesses, in addition to offering it as something for our community, our hobbyists, and K through 12. So when we want to have students that have an expansion beyond the high school, this provides them an opportunity both for mentorship as well as access to the tools themselves. So this is kind of looking at what is it to teach. Students really want a way to be creative. That's when they're gonna learn the most. They also want a way that they can be motivated by their curiosities and their interests, right? If I go up to a student and say, the reason you're going to learn about X, you know, the reason you're going to learn about the atom and how the atom works is because some standard told you that you should learn this, they're not very motivated by that. Unfortunately, we wish they were. Now, if instead I can say, you know what, let's try to accomplish something, let's try to do something, let's try and design something for a particular environment. Oh, by the way, you need to learn about that atom. You need to learn about some of these other concepts that are part of the same standards or a part of the educational process that we want to go through. But we're going to try and teach that through projects. We're going to try and teach that through active learning, right? And we're also going to use mentors. We're going to use members of our community to be a part of that learning process. Now, I want to give an example of this. Hopefully this will play. This is Centennial High School. They have an example of a makerspace. I was actually just over there this morning, or this afternoon. And it may not want to play.
Okay. And it doesn't start, you may want to describe it.
So what they have essentially done is take what was normally a library. It was a place to store books, and over time, that library has started becoming less and less used. You know, students didn't really want to go in there. They had the internet. They could look everything up. You constantly get this, well, why would I go find a book for that? I've got Wikipedia, right? Now, the answer to that is we reformed that library. It's still a location you can go to find books, but now it's becoming a location you can do so much more. They have all kinds of 3D printers, rapid prototypers, ways that you can essentially design something inside of the computer and hit the print button like you would with a document. And so instead of getting a document out, a bunch of words on a page, I get literally a 3D model. Something that can be small, something that can be big, and maybe I want to hook electronics to it. Well, we have soldering stations, we have electronic stations that are built into this. So now the students can make this thing move. They can start addressing real world problems while they're in their school. Now the challenge that we have in a space like Centennial is that they're limited on their capacity. They have, I believe, one professional and one full-time teacher that are supporting the space. Now, I ask them, what do you need the most? They say, we need community support, and we need to not have to maintain all of our equipment ourselves. There's certain things that fit very well inside the school, like a 3D printer. However, students that then have gotten to a certain level of manufacturing, so they've used the 3D printer, but now they want to expand, they want to do something more, they need access to those tools. Maybe a water jet cutter, a plasma cutter. There are a lot of different things that are much larger, harder to maintain, but they're very, very awesome tools that we'd like to give our students access to. We don't want to put that on the teachers, right? That's a very hard thing for a teacher to maintain. So we can bring that and bring them into the K-12 space. So how do we create a maker culture? And I promise I'm going to speed up as we go through here. So how do we create a K-12 culture? Well, we'd like to say we build it, they will come, right? We want to go through, we want to create a space, we want to create a building, we want to fully populate it and say, hey, here we are, show up, have fun. Unfortunately, and I can point you to lots of examples, this just does not work. You have to start instead from a culture. You have to build a culture. You can start even from an empty building. You can do soft opening on an empty building, and that can become your starting point, but you can't start without that culture. We have to have people that appreciate what they're doing, that want to build together, that want to mentor each other. How do we do this? Well, we have to come up with some sort of incentive, or some way to incentivize. So this can look like maybe it's paid staff that are part of it, or more importantly, maybe it's a way if you're in retirement, you're looking for a way to continue doing your hobbies, you want to come in, have free access to all of these tools, and oh, by the way, could you help us maintain some of these tools and also teach some of our kids? Well, to me, that means, yeah, you're giving back to the community, you should have access to a space like this. We can start leveraging that versus having to pay for absolutely everything that we do. We're going to have to pick some sort of way or model that we want to flow off of. This was put together looking at specifically like a university makerspace, but the same thing is true for communities. So we have a lot of people that would like to be a part of these types of things. I've already talked to a lot of you. And we can locate those people, pull them together, start saying, what would you like to create? What types of tools do you want to have? From there, we need to start saying, how do we move the barrier, remove the barriers of entry? Now, I'm not going to dive into details on all of this, but it's important to really note this, because again, it's how do you make the culture work versus just providing the space. So one of those is anxiety from lack of experience. You walk in, you don't know how to use a particular tool. We want to populate our space not only with the tools, but the experts that know how to use those tools. Those experts are all of you sitting right here. You can come in, you can help teach somebody how to use, say, woodworking tools or metalworking tools. You want to teach people based on the experience. You can start coming up with checklists, safety lists, so that they know that they're not going to get themselves in trouble. They're not going to hurt themselves, etc. You want to have a reduce the fear of alienation. There's a lot of ways that you can start to allow people to come together and to say, I'm glad you're here, I'm glad you're a part of this space, please come and join me on a lot of these projects. That has to be a core part of the culture. And then we have to get rid of this idea that, oh, a makerspace is only for X, it's only for engineers, it's only for technology people, it's only for people who want to go and sew. Right? We have to have this idea that everyone is a maker, and we want to build a community that's welcoming of everybody that's a part of our overall community. And so finally, we have to embrace diversity. You know, that's every type of person, any type of way that you want to break this down, we have to really embrace that as part of who we are as Roswell and how we want to run a space like this. So again, I want to pose, how does this come back? How does this help us as a community? So as a community, we want to do a couple of things. We want to do things like, we want to train our workforce. We want to have access to tools. We want to have extensions so that people that are in the K-12 environment have somewhere that they can go. They want to expand without burdening their teachers. We want to have a lot of leverage of the community experience. A lot of people in here have a lot of knowledge. We want to leverage that as best we can. Idea generation, that's going to be huge. Coming under the same roof to talk about things, you'd be surprised where the conversations can go and what kind of new ideas you come up with. And then finally, you have entrepreneurship support and you have the ability to create a true center in our city that you can walk through. So again, these are some of the tools that we can do. Just trying to go through here. Final questions again, I want to always bring this back. Who are we as Roswell? How do we want to build a culture in our community? And then how do we want to use that in order to further our economic development? So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. McNair, and the rest of the panelists. Appreciate your insight on all that. The way the rest of the evening is going to go is I'm going to ask each of the panelists a couple of questions that are relevant to what we're all interested in, and then it's your turn. And I'll put forth the basic premise upon which the questions will be asked from each of you, and I'll do that at the point where those questions are answered or asked and answered. In the meantime, it'll take about 10 minutes probably to get through these questions, and the microphone that you see in the middle of the room is the one where you get the opportunity to ask the questions. So a line will form, and then we'll go from there when we get to that part. So if you have a question, and in the next 5 to 10 minutes, feel free to make a line in the middle, and then we'll go from there. So, my questions. Dr. Hacker, you lived in Atlanta in the 80s, left for career purposes, came back. What have you seen in your absence that has developed that's the most positive? What are some potential negatives, and what do we as East Roswell need to do in order to make sure that we properly evaluate what the whole process as we move forward?
I have to tell you that in 25 years being away, I've been back now 5 years, it's just mind-blowing the amount of development that's occurred. And I think this is both good and bad. There used to be trees and forest here. Some of that's been replaced with developed space. We see the traffic coming here was a little startling to me, frankly. and I'm sure you're used to it, I'm not. I would just say that traffic suggests strong economic activity. Think about the places where there isn't traffic. Those aren't places you want to be. One of the things I think that you know, again, coming to this question of, you know, what do you want? What is the demand? Not what do you need, but what do you want? You know, what will attract and hold customers? And I think that a couple of things that should guide that coming back here, and that would be keep town and country development separate. You've already developed where you've developed. You're not going to get the trees back. Where I grew up in the Midwest, they sold the farms off and they became malls, and now people are saying, oh, don't we wish we could, you know, with farmers mean food. Well, there's no farmers there, it's all malls. And I think the thing to do if you've got places that are already developed is to redevelop those areas. I also think that's an important lesson I take away for Roswell, East Roswell, is to right size what you do. You don't have to fill a big box with another big box. You need to, you know, scale it in a way, perhaps whether it relates to the locality or if you're trying to attract people. It doesn't need to be giant to work. The corporations are moving away from that model. I think it's, you know, Roswell's not a giant, East Roswell's not a giant place. You want to embrace that model too.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Paul, you've been a leader in executing on opportunities and profitable growth in East Roswell. What do you see as East Roswell's greatest strength and greatest opportunity in the next 2 to 5 years?
I think most of East Roswell is centered around a good school system and a good residential. So we've got great residential, great school system. We've got river corridor. We've got fantastic parks, best park system probably in the southeast. And some great things have happened along those lines. So that's all backdrop. Even the new sidewalks have gone up and down Holton Bridge Road that we got all that money for, is, I think, are a big plus. I think the way East Roswell Park's connected back to the neighborhoods has been a great thing. I just think that we still don't have a hub of what we are. We don't have an identity. I think we've got to be more than just a group of bedrooms, you know, that are in a nice residential area. We've got to be something else. We've got to figure out what we want to be when we grow up. And I think that's the challenge. I think we've got the foundation, because the residential's so good, the housing's so good, the school systems are really, really good, but we're lacking the what's going to be next.
Thank you. Dr. McNair, you talked a lot about culture and developing the culture. What can we do as a community to make investments that also have a direct economic impact?
That's always a hard one. I think the biggest one is investing in our people. Finding ways that we can invest in, whether it's our students' future, finding ways that we can invest in really pulling out the ideas that we have as a community, and connecting each other, or connecting with each other through mentorship, et cetera. Once we start passing that knowledge around, we start being able to leverage that to encourage companies to come here. And I'm talking not necessarily your food chains, et cetera, but really the big companies, the Kimberly Clarks, folks like that, are really looking for a concerted effort to make sure that we have a pipeline of students, but also citizenship that is able to do a lot of the jobs that they want to be done.
Thank you. Steve, what do you see as highest priorities in developing a future where East Roswell maintains the balance of live, work, and play?
Well, I think you're starting it tonight. Tonight is an example of, and last week, it's getting the community. For too long, we've said no, but we left and got on 400. And we came home on Thursday night and our trash was picked up. And our kids played ball on Friday or Saturday night in the park. But now we need to take investment in our own neighborhood. For a business to be successful, to make it a live, work, play, Paul said it, you have to have connectivity. You got to be able to walk. You got to be able to ride your bike. I think our park system and our trail system is the beginning. But it's also going to take an investment. And we've got to decide as a community where that investment comes from. We don't like the word taxation. Man, it hurts me too. But at the end of the day, somebody has to pay for that. whether it's a maker space, whether it's creating a place to go eat and have a viable concern, or the new retail that's not this, that is the place where you touch it and feel it, or it's the puppy daycare. What are those services that we need within our community? To replace a big box is absolutely not the way to go. The rumor needs to be dispelled. IKEA is not locating in the Super Target. Take it away. Okay? I heard it four times today. This doesn't meet their business model. Target, I appreciate you saying that, closed, folks, because they didn't make a profit. Now, that's the unfortunate thing for you and I. But I will tell you, there's a Target on the west side of 400 that's thriving. Now, the demographic is important for you to understand. They're pulling from a larger market. Paul said it. The river becomes a natural barrier. Our density is not that strong in East Roswell. So, as we said, what do we look at? How do we downsize? How do we right-size what is right for this community? To be profitable? Has to be profitable if it's going to concern business. Or they can't sustain. How many restaurants have come and gone? Why? There's no day traffic. Somebody asked me, well, wait a minute. Why don't the people at Kimberly Clark, why do they not drive down to Taco Mac for lunch? I'll give you one good reason. They've got their own cafeteria and they support McAllister. It's across the street. Nobody wants to sit in traffic. The traffic's not going to go away. But for us to live, work, and play, we have to make walkable, connectable community.
Thank you. So that leads to the next question. Dr. Hacker, there seems to be divergent opinion on, one, attracting additional customers to support East Roswell business, and two, maintaining a quality of life by limiting traffic challenges. What steps should we take to accomplish both?
Well, as I said before, traffic's a sign of economic vitality. It's just not the sign you want. These are near impossible trade-offs. I was thinking about communities around Philadelphia that went to great lengths to limit traffic and to limit growth. My group was sued multiple times by groups that disputed our traffic studies, our development studies. The reason being was they did not want people coming to where they lived. They were perfectly happy leaving it undeveloped. Now, they went without things, there is no doubt about it, but they were against it, and that's not what they did. The flip of that was other communities I worked with that where some farmland opened up. They sold off to developers, and all the county council wanted to do was develop, 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 develop. They begged PennDOT, they begged every person in the world to build as many roads as they could humanly build, every cow path, every tow path, every place they could build it. That's what they wanted done. Now, I think I wasn't here, you know, when this development occurred over here. But I imagine 20 years ago or whenever it happened, you all had a meeting like this with people saying, why are they cutting down the trees to build it, put in a Target? And I think that some of these choices, you really have to think about that, you know, what you really want to be with this, because you've got a wonderful place, you've got a river, you got a lot of stuff. You talk about the river being a border, but to me the river sounds like a wonderful thing to have nearby. And so if you can somehow leverage those things, the nature you have, and like I said, keep what's built, built, and keep what's not built, unbuilt. You'd be surprised. It's the best amenity Roswell has.
Thank you, Dr. Hacker. I'll finish my questions, which is a hint that if you have questions, now would be a good time to stand in front of the mic. Paul, if you could take a look, do a little time travel with us into the future, maybe 10 years from now. And if you were to, from that perspective, look back and say, wow, East Roswell has made a lot of progress, what evidence would you point to that would allow us to understand what we're going to be doing over the next 10 years?
I just think in the community united and using the spaces that are left. I mean, even when the Supertarget got built and that 80 acres got those trees mowed down, I was shaking my head because there was a big, you know, where Steve River Girl now was all empty when that got mowed down. And if it got mowed down to have a forum where we had a bunch of things, the recession didn't stop, I probably have been all for it, but we didn't get that. So we got a half-baked cake that just happened for economic reasons. And now we've got to go back and fill a half-baked cake. And I'd like to see 10, 15 years from now, seeing it all be vibrant, seeing it being used, seeing the community grow from it, do some neat things that kind of bonds the community rather than just having, you know, empty retail boxes that we're putting sky zones and things like that in there. I mean, I don't think that's really the solution. The solution is to find something that really serves all of us, that makes money. And my vision for the Roswell Village would be to get a big developer like Riverwalk or somebody like that, and they would take that whole project over. Supertarget is owned by Supertarget. The rest of it's owned by a New York firm. Get the whole thing put together and redo the whole project for something that's good for the community, that's economically viable. Somebody's got enough pockets to launch it, make it great, so that 10 years from now you're like, wow, you know.
Thank you very much. And thank you again for volunteering your time for this evening, panelists. I really appreciate that. So the way this works with the audience participant Q&A is that in order to be fair to everybody in the room, the best thing that we can do is allow each person to ask one question. And to frame it, try to make one sentence for your frame of the question, one sentence for the question itself, or just the question. So just two basic, a comment and a question, and then you're done. If it goes more than a sentence, I'm gonna have to cut you off because we wanna make sure that everybody has a chance and we'll go forward much better way. So the way this works is we'll focus on the future. If you could identify which panelist you're addressing the question to, that'd be very helpful. Once you've asked your question, please listen to the answer and allow the next person in line to ask their question. If you have another question, just walk to the end of the line. You'll have potentially an opportunity to do that. At about 8:30, we'll break for the closing remarks and of all the panelists and all the folks in Roswell, City of Roswell, that want to make comment. So with that, we can entertain our first question.
This is specifically for Mr. Hirschberg. Our youngest daughter won't graduate high school until 2034. Okay? We've been in Horseshoe Bend for about 6 years. Our plan is to stay there until she's out of high school. So we're here for the long term. Our concern is that whatever happens here will be a knee-jerk reaction or temporary fix. We're not interested in that. In your opinion, what would be the best long-term solution to add identity, like Canton Street has in, over in Roswell proper? What can we add here that will be our Canton Street? Thank you.
That's a great question. It's something I think about a lot. I mean, you know, I called Rich DiPolito up before the meeting because he developed the Supertarget complex. I want to know what he thought. You know, I called Rob Bent, asked Rob, you know, what he thought. You know, just some of the developers were successful in the area, and what they thought could go in there and what could work. And I think we need something in there that's big enough that the whole development of East Roswell Village is one big thing. you know, and I think if you look at other millennial places that have come, that have been successful, they've had density, they've had live, work, play, built into all one things. I mean, you know, I get excited to go to Avalon because there's a lot to do there. It's an experience. You do something in East Roswell, it's an experience. It's good. You know, the great thing about the makerspace, it's kind of hard from what Dave was saying to understand. I went down and toured at Georgia Tech, what he has there. This would be very good for our kids. I mean, what he's talking about would be excellent to build some kids in an America that's not very technologically savvy compared to other parts of the world. This would be fantastic, and this would be a great piece to what we're talking about doing in a community center. Another story I heard was an auditorium in the old coal space. You know, we don't have an indoor pool or any kind of pool facility. It'd be awesome for kids. It'd be awesome for the community if we had something like that in the coal space, if Roswell wanted to get behind it. You know, East Roswell Park, when my kids were very small, we went to do activities. We always went to Roswell. Roswell Area Park has the hub of all the activities. Fantastic program guide. Any new neighbor that ever moves in, I always have kids. I give the program guide, said anything from going dancing with your grandmother to Dad and me, Valentine's Day is in there. But it's all over there. It's a lot less over here. So the question is, how do you get the balance in there when you have a hub? I can't tell you what the hub's going to be, but it needs to be a family-centered hub that's economically viable, that makes money. If it doesn't make money, makerspace is great, but you can't make money just for the makerspace. It has to be one more thing that's added in. If you haven't ever seen this, because David lives up here, it's worth seeing what goes on at Georgia Tech. I was pretty fascinated when I went down there. It takes a lot to get it going, but there's one in Decatur. Where else are they in the metro? Just Decatur?
Yeah. We've got them in Decatur, we've got them in downtown, we've got them up in Gwinnett, we've got them in Marietta, we've got them all around, but there's not anything that's in the North Fulton area, with the exception of a couple co-work spaces and things like that.
Thank you.
General Motors behind it, and the Home Depot and some other places behind it. Something like that that would bring the community together would be really neat. It's not just about building doing a fabrication of metal or wood, it's about the process of going through and doing robotics and inventing things. Gives kids skill sets. I mean, people that graduate from Georgia Tech that got major experience get launched into business like crazy, don't they?
Yeah. I was going to say, one of the other things at Georgia Tech, we have a bunch of incubators that are attached to all of this. So if you talk about the economic viability, there's a lot there. We have about $10 billion worth of investment that we've gotten for a lot of the projects that came straight from those makerspaces.
Thank you. Very good. So I've been asked to, apparently there were some cards that were going around and people wrote some questions. So I'm going to intersperse these questions with those that are standing in line. So one of the questions is, suggestions on how and to whom, to and when improvements will be made, cosmetic use with current standing stores, gas stations, etc. Kroger equals poor, upkeep, selection, etc.
Not exactly.
Who wants to?
Steve?
Well,
I mean,
Go ahead.
I don't have an answer. I'm just trying to. When I hear that, it sounds like, because there's actually been interesting discussion. We've heard a lot about the apartments in the Northwest Quadrant apartments. It's really just, what can we do? If whoever wrote that wants to better clarify, send it to me like it was asking, though. What can you do to encourage retail locations that don't have proper upkeep and don't look like today's standard? Is there anything you can do where the business is staying there, but you're encouraging them to really look better for the community? That's how I just heard that question. I didn't write it with whoever wants to stand up.
Okay, thank you. You can ask your question.
Call your property owner.
I mean,
how do we do that?
I'll give you an example. I think the Chevron is finally getting remodeled by McDonald's over the corner in Nesbitt Ferry and Holbrook. That thing has looked like a dump forever. And I hope when they get done with it, it looks better. But to me, that thing's atrocious. And to me, it's surprising that the neighborhood hasn't ever said anything. I pick up the phone and call Chevron corporately a few times to say, come on, guys. You know, how weak does that thing look? When I bought my Kids or Kids franchise, you know, it was abysmal. There were pieces falling off the building when I went in there and bought it. And you know, it wasn't economically viable for the owner at the time, so they didn't reinvest the money back into it. You know, the strip of land by Horseshoe Bend was all torn up. Nobody put any money into it. It's hard. The business has to be viable to support it. But I also think that we have a voice. I think when things aren't right, people need to complain and do something about it rather than accept it. I think that we shouldn't accept things that look poor if they don't look the way we want them to look in the neighborhood. And sometimes it's just a matter of us getting together and building consensus and letting somebody know whoever owns that franchise would do better if it looked better. For some reason, they're not going to do it.
Yeah, the biggest pressure you can give is as citizens is to reach out to those franchise owners or reach out to those franchisors. Because at the end of the day, our city government can enforce code. They can make sure that the building's safe, that it has all the pieces and parts that have to meet regulation and code, but they can't make them paint. So sometimes it's peer pressure. Sometimes it's the reality of somebody knocking at their door. Sometimes it's pushing that franchisee out so that you get a new Verizon where the Chevron was at the corner of Old Alabama or Old Roswell Road and Holcomb Bridge, where you get a complete redevelopment, and that's redevelopment. And that's what it's gonna take. Like businesses follow like businesses.
Thank you.
One thought on that. I developed a piece of property with a business partner at East Cobb. East Cobb has a Facebook called East Cobb Snobs. We built it, had a CO about to move into it. They didn't like the color of the building we built, and the councilman called us in and said, son, you're not getting your CO if you change the color. And I said, we already approved this. I said, sorry. East Cobb Snobs have worn out that councilman so much he would not let us get a CO. And you know what that is? That has nothing to do with the law. That's a bunch of angry women. That's what if East Roswell lacks one thing, it's unity and purpose sometimes. If we don't have the unity, we don't fight for it, we get what we get. And when we've sat back and accepted a lot of things over time, you guys shouldn't turn into Horseshoe Bend and see trash in the median and pay your property taxes and not complain to Roswell. That's ridiculous. I'm not paying property taxes on my commercial buildings to go have to look over pork and tires, a piece of junk in the middle of the median and Holcomb Bridge. We shouldn't accept it.
Thank you.
My name is Jennifer Art, and I live in the Lost East Roswell. My name is Jennifer Art, and I live in the Lost East Roswell neighborhood of Bull Springs or Country Club of Roswell or whatever the HOA has decided to call us now. And we are literally the only neighborhood that's bordered by Johns Creek and Alfred on both sides. So a lot of times we're ending up in Avalon and Spencer's Things to Do. And there's a lot of angry women in Roswell, so we probably know what the East Cobb folks. My question really to whomever is, what is the thought on two things? One is, I think we need to do something with the river. So many cities that have rivers, San Antonio places, it's nice, and when the weather's nice, it's nice to be on the river and some way to do that. I don't know if there's issues. But the other thing is, something like a Ponce City Market, or Faneuil Hall, if anybody's ever been to Boston. I think what you're doing up there is people who have small businesses but can't afford to get another building.
So what's your question? I'm sorry.
But the question is, would that be something that might be viable? Or maybe I just throw it out to the people to think about. But would that be something that's viable, that kind of thing where people who have businesses can come and have their little stall, a little like the antique shop, but more like a Ponce City Market or a Faneuil Hall or one of those kind of places?
Yes.
I think absolutely, and I will tell you that those same developers are looking at Roswell. We've got to be, and tonight is again, I will...
East Roswell.
I will clarify. There's always an analogy. You have to have a willing seller, a willing buyer, and a willing person to redevelop. And right now, we do not have a willing seller at Kohl's. Is that not correct, Councilman Marcelo? They are not really excited about selling. So we have to find a way to give them something, some way to redevelop. I agree with what you're saying. I think we hold on. So, but again, it starts with tonight. And I think what you're talking about is very correct. It's gotta economically work, okay? Because I guarantee they didn't think about losing $80 million in 2005 when that was planned. But at the same sense, you've got developers that do want to look at the east side of 400. They do look at east side. We had two projects, not either one of the community wanted. We understand that. But I think it was very key that we had developers that were willing to come in. And what we've got to do is say, what will we accept? What will we allow? Because those developers will come out.
So I want to keep it real short so we can get to a lot more questions. I love the idea of like a Ponce City Market, Crog Street, a lot of these types of developments. And so one of the things I would recommend is we need to come up with what that looks like for us, whether that's just shops and restaurants, whether that has other components in it. Because keep in mind, we still have that density issue. So we want to create some way that we're bringing people into whatever space that is. They have, again, I'm a makerspace person, so I'll tell you that a makerspace is a way you can bring people in. But there's lots of others. But we need to think about what is it that we want to have that would bring people into a space like that so that they'll want to go shopping at all of those places. Another piece of that is really focusing on entrepreneurship. How do we have people that are already a part of our city be the ones that are enabled by having storefronts inside of something like a Ponce City Market, or having the ability to start their own restaurant because they're an upcoming chef, things like that. So how do we focus internally on what our community is in addition to reaching out to other maybe national chains, et cetera, that might be interested?
Thank you very much. Now for a question on the card.
This is a quick one for you, Steve.
Yep.
Tomorrow's News Today mentioned in an article today, IKEA was looking at the Target and Rack Room Share. two questions here for you.
Sure.
Is Rack Room Shoes closing also? And do you have any further information on IKEA's interest?
So, that's a good one. Rack Room has announced that they are closing, unfortunately. Again, I think we've heard it a couple times up here. Some reason people didn't shop there. They do not go in and finish out a store and turn around and close it if people aren't shopping. So I think it's very important to remember people are not shopping in these stores or they would not be closing them. So that's where we're at on it.
Thank you. Next question, please.
Okay, my question is either for Mr. Hack, I guess, or for one of the city council members here. The issue I see is we have brilliant ideas and we want a holistic concept, but when I look at something like Target, so Target owns the Target property, the developer or some other company owns another piece of that, the same at Kohl's. So Pep was renting from Kohl's, but Kohl's owns only that chunk. Kroger is a different owner. Who can be the authority or the group or the whatever who brings this together to get a holistic concept? Because what I see wherever I go is there's a little chunk that's converted into something. That, and then when you talk about a museum or changing your vision, by the movie theater on Mount Vernon, they do that. But it's only that back corner because it's five different owners of the whole chunk. And we have the same thing here in East Roswell. It's so many different owners. Not only the question, how do we entice somebody
just to summarize your question, you know, how do we as a community pull these groups together to be able to make sure that there's an effective action that can take place?
And then get it through, because there's also an opposition from 10 different groups that tends to happen.
Thank you. Who wants to take that one?
That's me. Nobody. Yeah, everybody just throw their arms up. No. I think, I emphasize how important these meetings are, because again, we are talking about what we want as a community. What do we want? You know, nice lady in the back said, well, wait a minute, it's all happening on the west side. Well, no. It affects everybody. And I think that starting these conversations, starting focus groups out of these residents, you, Professor Hacker said it, we have a very unique situation. We have an open, blank canvas. Yes, we do have empty boxes, but it's right now. You got your elected officials. See, you've got them in the audience. I think it's important that, you know, one of the questions was asked me earlier, what's it gonna take? It's gonna take leadership. It's gonna take concerted effort by us to say, you know what? No doesn't work. No got us where we are. So what are we going to do together as a community? And I will vouch this, that Roswell Inc. will do everything we can to facilitate, because we want the jobs here, whether it's in the makerspace, the restaurant industry, which is 6,000 employees in the city of Roswell, folks. 6,000 people, but they can't live here. You know, the makerspace is a great idea and I love it, but we also have to have residential. We have to have a place for them to work and then a place for them to live. So we have to look at those things and see what will we accept to make those walkable communities. Your question earlier, live, work, play. You gotta be able to walk or be able to go a short distance.
Thank you. Next written question, please.
And this one's actually pretty related to a lot of the conversation we saw, but what is the plan to make more areas of Roswell destinations instead of only places to run errands? And so obviously we saw today discussion of the makers makerspace. Also on social media, I had seen a lot of residents discussing a music venue and how that really can excite people, and there's spaces for that. But what's the panel's thoughts?
Let me throw one out there. Where I lived previously, one of the things they did, they had a meeting like this, and they put up all the kind of things we're talking about here. And what they did was they built an indoor ice skating rink in the middle of a park. It seemed crazy at the time. It seemed absolutely crazy. I'm here to tell you that for the last 10 years I lived in Philadelphia, this place was rented out 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They had it was the only one in, you know, the whole region. I'd take my daughter during free skate times. It was hockey teams from around there. And what happened was it became like they were having the regional championships there. And it was just nutty because the arguments originally were about, we want to preserve the ball diamonds. We want to preserve some of these, you know, park areas for outdoor things. They put in this, there was opposition, of course. And what it became was the jewel of the park system in where I lived in Havertown, Pennsylvania. And I mean, it was an amazing thing. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So if you want to think about thinking outside the box, and you want to think about activities that are going to last, you need to think about things that you would want to do, things that you would want to do with your children, things you did as a kid, the makerspace, all these things work. When you start talking about, you know, Pond City markets and these things, the things that you're forgetting, and I think you're getting at it very well, is that you need density around it. You need the people. I live right near there, and all the people that are there, the traffic has not picked up the way you would think it would because they built the housing around it. So everyone, what you have to do is you drive through and are waiting for all the people to cross the street from the apartments. So, I mean, you really need to think bigger. Think about the things you really, 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 really want to do, the things you would want to do with your kids. And I think that you're getting closer, and that your willingness to take on density to make some of those things happen.
Thank you very much. Next question, please.
My question was originally going to be about what she asked. So the next question is, how do we keep some of the green space when it doesn't profit a company? It doesn't bring money in. We want to redevelop what we have. How do we stop continuing development until we get this worked out?
Who would like to take that? Is this?
I'll do it.
Let me say, I might be the anti-development person up here, quite frankly. In the economics and the things that I teach and look at around the country, a lot of times not developing is the best economic choice. Selective not development, I want to be careful with this. One reason is that you got to keep it up, right? So the initial capital cost, you find some other way to do it, you pay for it, but you know what? You're stuck having it cleaned up. You're stuck having the maintenance on it for the rest of forever. And that's when owners and so forth walk away. So I just caution you, like I said, 10 years ago or 20 years ago when you were building these developments out here, I'm sure you had opposition to keep the trees, and now you're worried about what do we do with the thing that's been left behind. If that was still trees, you wouldn't be worried about it, would you?
Thank you. Next written question, please.
I can feel for the people that did write the cars, though.
They're
standing. This is a democracy.
Just one more, and then we'll do that.
This will be the last one, and it's what can be done to increase the market footprint a business can serve/operate in. Most places in Roswell, you can draw a circle around, say, they have a 5-mile radius of service. You can't do that in East Roswell, river, county line, et cetera.
Who wants to take that one?
Well, that's a tough one to answer, because if you think about it, I go back to the West Roswell Target and that shopping center. They are adding an additional 15,000 square feet to that shopping center. it's 100% leased. Okay, that's Super Target. Kings Road, the Walgreens, where the Taco Mac, Kings Road, Crossville, 100% leased. So we got to look at the key word we've been talking about is density. How do you get, you've got to have, be able to pull from a certain area for those to be viable. Any business. If you're a service, if you're an attorney, it's a destination business. We're going to see that attorney for a reason. If we're going to the doctor, we're going to that doctor for a reason. McDonald's, Paul talked about it. We're going to go to that, actually, Marcelo talked about it. We're going to go to that McDonald's because it's convenient, it's on the corner, we're going to grab that McDonald's. But how do we get people to Foundation Social Leader? We need to drive people in there. Well, we've got to have numbers. The businesses aren't as strong on the east side. You just got sheerly, the numbers aren't here. So I think the answer to your question is we've got to continue to have the right kind of mix of housing, and we've got to be able to support. Remember, big statistic, majority of this community leaves this community every day to go to work someplace else. They don't work here. Alpharetta, I'll give you an example. 168,000 people in the city of Limits during the day. 72 on pillows at night. We're 94,000 people. During the day, we're about 85,000 to 90,000 here in the city. We need to stay and work in our own city.
So, I would like to expand also on this question. You know, we keep blaming density, density, density. It's like everybody have to live on top of the coffee shop to sustain the nail salon downstairs. So, but let me tell you numbers, because we talk about numbers. I have here from Concordia Properties, who developed Super Target 8 years ago, some numbers of demographic. They claim that in a 3 miles radius from Super Target, there is 75,600 the population is 75,600. I call this some kind of density. I mean, 75,000 people to support something that really adds value to the community is plenty of people to support a business. So here, it's not much about the density. This is what I put the slide early on, so we don't confuse about density and the right concept to develop to bring people as a destination place. Look about the forum. Do you see 20 million people living on top of the forum to sustain the business? No, but what they did, they create a real good destination place that attract people maybe for more than 3 miles around. So we keep blaming density, and we are mixing here. And this is what I had this slide early on to clarify this point, that we cannot keep blaming density for any kind of destination place that is not what really people want and is not, you know, an innovation place. So that is what I want to say about the density and the numbers. I guess council member is very much.
I want to address that as well, because frankly, if I was a better politician, I would just stay quiet and sound neutral. But I do really believe in just really confronting the more difficult parts of the conversation, because I think what I wouldn't want to get out of tonight is just we talk a lot and then nothing happens. And I think instead, if we are going to really be able to take action and continue to move forward, and again, change does not happen in one night. This has been many years in the making. But what I want to address, and similar to what I brought up at the beginning, is the fact that I think we really do have to have a lot of good feedback and dialogue from the people, because there are trade-offs. And in reality, if we had even more apartments and a lot of high rises, frankly, that would be very beneficial for our retail. It'd be a lot more rooftops. At the same time, there's a trade-off associated with it, whether it's our school systems, our character, I'm not trying to give anyone else an opinion. I want really each of you to be able to speak up. But it's very easy to say that we have these challenges because we don't have enough density. And even though I'm someone obviously that's been vocal about the concern of really too many apartments, being added, changing the character. At the same time, I will absolutely admit that could help our retail, but as discussed by the panelists, there has to be really... But the reason I bring that up is I want to make sure that we really are tackling the tough parts, because there are decisions to make. I appreciate that.
Thank you. Next question.
My name is Lee Flint. I live in Marcus Landing. And I first want to thank Marcelo and Mike for holding this. I call them my M&M boy. Of course, I'm a man of mayor's ear guy. Okay? Thank you very much for bringing this here. I think that this panel has probably missed the single most important issue to everyone in East Roswell.
And your question?
You made light to it, okay? And Mr. Hacker, I'm presenting this question to you because you made reference to Avalon. Uh-huh. Of course, you didn't state the reality that what Alpharetta did is they turned Old Milk Highway into a six-lane highway with turn lanes before they laid one brick in Avalon. Holcomb Bridge out here.
But before you get too much further, what's your question, please?
It's about traffic. The people are saying, let me talk. Thank you. Thank you. Back to what I was getting to. You got off Holcomb Bridge out here between Old Alabama and the Gwinnett Line from 4 till 7 at night. It's a parking lot. Okay? You talk about 70,000 people living in Roswell during the day. During the day, at rush hour, morning, afternoon, night, Holcomb Bridge is a parking lot. You go to the city of Roswell and you ask them, hey, when are you going to resurface Holcomb Bridge? The road is separating. And again, that's a Georgia Department of Transportation issue, but yet the Georgia Transportation issue takes care of West Roswell. They take care of Alpharetta.
So we really have to get to a question. And the question that I'll paraphrase.
No.
Or ask.
Don't speak.
Please do.
Please. Okay? I want to know why we don't have real-life traffic on Holcomb Bridge like is in Alpharetta, where you can drive from one side to the other, and you can drive from Holcomb Bridge all the way up to the Avalon in 7 minutes, and from coming out of Holcomb Bridge to go to Roswell, not too bad, coming back, it'll take 45 minutes. When is this city going to wake up and address the infrastructure issues that are negatively impacting transportation?
Thank
you. That is what killed Riverwalk Lodge that you referenced and got these gentlemen elected, was the traffic and the fear of traffic. Thank you.
Well, I certainly can't speak to anything related to Georgia DOT or the decisions you've made previously, but frankly, if you live in a place where you have to drive everywhere, then you're going to have cars on the road. That's just the reality of what you have. end of sentence.
So can anyone answer the question about the investment in the infrastructure? Because I think that was the key question. What's holding up infrastructure and who's responsible for making that investment? Is that a good paraphrase?
Yes.
I think it's a great question. Apparently, we don't have the right answer this evening. Next question, please.
Thank you, Mr. Lee. Alan Bradley, I'm a Roswell resident since 1998. Comment and then question. David, I've got two engineer sons at George Tech, so your jackets. Paul, my daughter, Becca, works for you. Kids are kids after school at Centennial.
Just a good job.
and actually, my question is for you, Paul. So, recognizing that really what makes Roswell different from everywhere else in North Fulton is our character. And summarizing it up is the parks and the green space and history, right? In a summary, there are two things that I see are the viable ways for us to go ahead and achieve the right development or redevelopment moving forward. I'm curious from your perspective, Paul, which or both do you think is the right and how to do it? The first time we talked at length about a destination, and I considered high-end mixed-use destination, and that being Avalon, which we discussed. The other would be redevelopment of sort of high-tech corporate parks. They could be hoteling parks, not hotels, but hoteling parks, and that would drive in good employers that are going to drive good daytime services and retail, and then the high-end mixed use will drive family expenses and on nights and weekends. So is it one or the other in both? And the answer to that gentleman previously, we just voted T-Splost, and that's supposed to be dedicated to North Fulton. So it's there already, folks. It just needs to get dedicated. Let's get our fair share in Roswell.
Thank you.
I think it's a great question. I mean, I think that we don't have enough commercial office space over here. We know that. That's one of the issues. And I think that you can look at something like a downtown Woodstock project. That's kind of neat, where they have some office in there and they have some high rise that's in there. And yeah, we don't want apartments, but if you had higher level condos and it made things work, we could have places that people worked in and didn't have to commute down to the cars on Holston Bridge Road, that would work. But, when I talked to Rob Bins, he mentioned that we don't have a big convention center. If anybody wants to have an event in North Fulton, there isn't a space, is there? There's nothing in Roswell. There's nothing on our border that has anything like that. So it has to be something that's progressive, that has less drive-by traffic, it's a destination. We don't have enough office condo. There's not enough place for people to open businesses around here. We have issues with that. So, all that whole mix of things we need. Ice skating rink, great idea. That's we had a big old indoor ice skating rink. It was a destination that people went to on the weekends. That'd be fantastic to have that as something to anchor that neighborhood around there. Something, it's just something like that that gets people out to come to it if we want. There's a host of different things, but we have to come together as a community to decide what we want.
Thank you.
You don't have to knock down more trees. We've got enough space.
Thank you very much. Next question, please.
Thank you. Yes. My name is Quan Harris, and I actually stay in the Holcomb Crossing. And my question is actually for the city council. Coming on my road is Dogwood Road, and we have hotels that are high in crime, and they are, this gentleman, I'm sorry, I can't remember your name, but they're high in crime, and he also stated something that if you see, your city's looking tore down, you gotta speak up about it. This is my real concern. Coming down my road is sometimes you don't know what you're gonna get. We got roadblocks, we have shootings, I go to the corner store, and this guy's out there shooting, and I have a little 7-year-old daughter. And so my concern is cleaning up Dogwood Road. I really need that service.
That's a great question, sir. I appreciate you coming here and asking that. And it's definitely a challenge we have that I think we need to be working harder to address. In conversations with the chief of police, he stresses he feels we can't just police our way out of it. We of course make sure to try to have that presence, but there's the issues you absolutely comment on. Something I actually brought forward in 2016 and didn't gain support. And again, I bring it up because all of you ultimately are should be making the decisions for what goes on in Roswell. I wanted to have staff look at, because you mentioned some of those hotels right there, for example, a lot of crime, a lot of issues. Not only affecting
$25 a night,
and not only affecting your family for being nearby there, but affecting everyone for the taxes and the resources that are used with that crime, etc. So there is a law in Georgia that you have the ability to actually have specific tax districts. And what I wanted to ask is these areas where just so crime ridden, to be able to specifically draw it in these areas where we could actually get more police support, more help, more support, whatever it takes to really, really clean that up and be paid by those hotels. Unfortunately, that was something there was not support for, but my hope is we can really get staff, we can get the elected officials to want to get staff to look at doing that, because by having those individuals paying that specific tax rate for that district, it'd be that money would go just to that area to make sure that it is really clean, it is safe. So that's an idea I've had, but certainly a challenge, and it's been a long-term challenge with how profitable some of those are over there.
I'm sorry, who owns those hotels that we can write or complain or Because those hotels, when I moved here, they were there, but I believe they were shut down, and it was a very quiet neighborhood. Now, I can't go down that neighborhood without seeing cops staking out and like I said, shootings and everything like that. It's ridiculous over there. And that's not what I moved to Roswell for.
Yeah, absolutely. Steve, do you know
the
owners of those?
We know we can get you the names of those owners. Most of those owners you're talking about right on Dogwood are within the Atlanta area. So, again, it's a matter of putting on the pressure from the community and what the community is willing to. Because, there's one of the key words I said. It takes leadership. These guys have taken leadership tonight to come up and do this for them. I think it's important that they listen to that because that is a key part, is being able to look at affordable housing, which is a tough nut to talk about in Roswell. It is a tough nut to say affordable housing, but it's got to be workforce housing. Janet made the comment just a minute ago. There's no place for these 6,000 people that work in these restaurants that we love to eat in all over Roswell. They can't afford to live in Roswell. And unfortunately, they can't get here. So even though we have one of the lowest unemployment rates in the whole metro area in Roswell, we have to import our workers. And that means truly from Norcross, Woodstock, and far away, because they can't afford to live and work in the same place. So if we want to be able to live, work, community, live, work, play, we've got to have all the elements that come with that. Density also, that's a key word. Everybody thinks that it's all about apartments or all about multifamily. It's not. It's about density of having the right kind of offices in the right kind of area. Allow those offices so they can be in that area. And what does that look like? Because good offices from small entrepreneurs and corporate folks that will come in and support these maker type spaces, we are all about that in Roswell. That's what Roswell's made at. That's the core of Roswell.
Thank you.
I wanted to jump in real quick on the kind of the crime issue. I actually just went to the Citizens Police Academy here in Roswell, so big thanks to the police department for putting that together. If there's anybody that can go through that, I highly recommend it. One of the things that I heard was this idea that idle minds lead to crime. Mm-hmm. And one of the ways that we can address having a lot of crime in our area is providing more things for these, especially kids, to go do. A lot of them are not looking to just go make trouble just for the sake of going make trouble. There are some of those. A lot of times they just don't have anything better to do. They don't see a way out of whatever situation they're in. And the more that we can provide those types of opportunities to them, the more we can kind of pull them away from trying to be a problem in the first place, and then us having to invest more money in the police force, the police having to get into these weird situations with them.
Thank you. So, a matter of basic housekeeping, looks like we have potential for a lot more questions than we have time available to us. Originally we thought 8:30 would be the cutoff of questions. We could probably extend it about another 10 minutes. So, depending upon question and answer speed, will depend on how many people get through. So, do you want to ask your question?
Thank you. My name is Marie Wilsey, and I'm a 20-year resident of Portland. I just wanted to thank you all for coming and setting this up, Marcelo and Mike, and thank you all for being here. My main interest is, you know, how do we bring the community together, and how do we create a vision and a plan for the next steps that will be attractive to businesses and to investors and to maybe public-private partnerships to make some of these ideas happen? So my question is for you, Dr. Hecker, I mean, what is a process that we can follow from here? And maybe how is that work with some of the other communities that you have worked in Pennsylvania?
Thank you.
Great. It's a great question. And it would take too long for me to answer all of it. But let me throw, there are, I know that obviously the council's here and they're listening. There are processes, things like charrettes, where people are getting, get people together and have them work through ideas that reveal what we call hidden preferences. I spent a lot of time doing these things. And there are a number of these kinds of interactive processes that would permit you to be, for everyone to sort of build something that provides meaningful input, not just input, but meaningful input. And I think what I mean by meaningful input is something I'm hearing here is that It's going to ask you to weigh the costs and the benefits. And it sounds easy, but if we told you that building apartments would make certain things viable, would you be willing to do it? No, right? Amen. But at the same time, it might be the way to keep what you have, and it may be the way, something like that may be the way that your children are going to be able to stay living in Roswell, or East Roswell, whatever. And I think it's important to recognize that, you know, that you gotta, that these kinds of activities, you know, are by weighing the cost and the benefits, they consider everyone, not just the people that are here, but the people also that aren't here, and the people that are gonna be here, your children, you know, their ability to live here too, and that's what we really want, right?
Thank you. Next question, please.
Can you hear me? Okay. My name is Heidi, and I live in Marcelo. And I'm addressing all of you because you asked us all what brings people to Roswell. And here's my idea. And my idea is to envision something that is already existing and works very well and is not far from here. You almost probably know the Peachtree Forum and Peachtree Corners. A cute little shopping center, not just a shopping center. It's a walk area, it's a play area, it's an eat area, and it's a shop area. And people go there from all over, and they park their cars there, and they spend the days there, and evenings to eat, and then they go home. This is what we need. And already we have
a plan. I'm sorry, do you have a question?
No, the question will be in just a moment.
we don't have it.
Basically, what the place already exists in the Roswell East Village Shopping Center. We need the space and a little bit more to do that. So anyway, my question is actually not a real particular question. It is just, what do you think of that?
Thank you very much.
Paul's giving me the your turn, but and I appreciate it. I think it's absolutely, which we've got to do is find the right ingredients. We've got to find all the right parts to make that work. And again, I think what we heard tonight, we got to continue to hear that. Because somebody said, what about the people that aren't here? Go to the survey. The city put up a survey last week. Go to that survey, fill it out. We need Roswell East residents. We need you to go next door to your neighbor and say, fill this out, tell us what you want. So because if we don't know what it is that you want, remember what I said early on, the good developers do not want to come in and fight to redevelop, to even replant trees, which we all would love to see. They're not going to fight you as a community. We are the community. We're the backbone. So we've got to say what it is we want. So fill out the surveys, and then we can combine all these ideas, and then we have to get non-emotional. And that really is hard because, you know, we're adamantly against one thing or the other. But we've all got to sit at a table and negotiate out what that looks like. Nobody up here said we need multifamily. We said density is part of the solution, but what does that density look like? That doesn't mean that's the solution. The solution could be a combination of a lot of things. But we've got to be able to say we can sit in a room and talk about it like adults.
Steve, what's the access point of that survey so that people that don't know how to get to it?
Somebody, what is it? You just go right into the City Hall website. I think it's the banner right now. No. They're on the city. Yeah, it's on the survey. It's a survey. You can access it on Nextdoor, but it is on the roswellgov.com. Yes.
Thank you. Next question, please. This could be one or two more.
Okay, I'll be very brief. I am a new business owner here in Roswell, and investor. I chose to come to Roswell because I thought it was the best place in the entire GTA to come and open a business. My business is, I'm the first franchisee outside of the perimeter, and I chose to come here for a very good reason. I wanted to say that you've got a very good example here in the Connection Plaza. That is a redevelopment that is successful. Yesterday, I started a merchants association. We're getting together. You've got people like Circle Noodle, the From to Earth Brewing Company Foundation. I have customers telling me every day how wonderful it is. Thank God you're here. So in all of the down, or the dark cloud. I'm just saying that there's a bright sky there. You've already got a great example. Just do more of it. That's the encouragement. The question is, how do we do more of it?
What is your business?
Thank you.
Tell me great.
And we appreciate you doing that and opening in Roswell. Important to know that that office park behind you at Holcomb Woods is 94% leased. Those are the folks too that come, not only the neighbors, but those people that come out to make sure that they go to Foundation and Taco Tsunami and those other restaurants and Kale Me Crazy and the Starbucks, you know, very successful getting out of that corner and getting in where they are now. Verizon, they made strategic decisions. So we know that the traffic is starting to pick up. We fill office. Office brings retail. We know that.
Thank you. Next question, please.
Okay, so I'm a new resident of Roswell. Okay, so I was saying I'm a new resident of Roswell. And I'm a little concerned that kind of all of you are in agreement that this maker's idea is a good idea. What we need is something similar to what the gentleman in front of me was saying about. We need people investing, we need people opening business. We don't need another sort of, you know, utopia of hippie utopia of people helping each other and we need volunteers teaching people how to carpool. That's what we need this place to be that. We don't need to develop something else for them. What we need is more businesses, and that's what I think we should focus on, and not more places run by underpaid government.
Thank you. Next question, please.
I'm Sean Wright, and I've lived in Roswell for 11 years, and we keep having a lot of these same conversations. You mentioned leadership. You know, getting this community and any community to come to a plurality or an agreement on one or two things to do is going to be very difficult. So how do you go about establishing a threshold to where the decision gets pushed rather than everything just stopping, and then 10 years from now we're sitting here wondering why something didn't get done because maybe 15% of the people weren't in agreement. But how do you establish that threshold, and what is that threshold? Because that comes back to leadership and getting people to catch that vision.
Thank you. And it kind of built on a prior question about how do we develop cohesiveness and how do we make decisions to move forward. Any final thoughts on that?
So I can speak again to some of the work that I've been doing in the maker movement, how we bring those together. There's a lot of different ways to do this. One of them is building a community first through something like Meetup or some of those types of sites and having everybody start to come together and have conversations.
That's not the question. The question is how do you establish a threshold to make a decision to move forward versus...
Okay, so the question is how do we establish a threshold, a critical mass, in order to make a decision? Correct. So again, it's you have to, in a sense, the best way that I know to do this and that I've seen successful is you go talk to a lot of people, you eventually get a lot of those people in a room to establish an idea, and then an idea is able to be gravitated towards, and more people get behind it. You're able to go talk to city council, you're able to have the city council buy into it, as well as other members buy into it, and that builds momentum as you go. Bad ideas tend to lose that momentum, they tend to die off. Good ideas, if you get somebody who's really motivated behind it, can really get a lot of people really moving, and I've seen that happen very successfully.
Thank you. And we're getting the hook to a certain degree. If we could identify closing comments and allow each of you to have your thoughts. Steve, it's up to everybody. One more, yes or no? Okay, go for it.
Is the city going to buy the Shirley property and convert it into a park? This is for council. Marcel? Is the city going to buy the Shirley property and convert it to a park?
I will just say this right now, we are talking to the property owners. That's all we can say. All right. That's one thing I think we've got a tremendous amount of support for.
There are about,
I know that I've got enough votes if I need it. Seven branches. Seven branches. It's on off Eaves Road and Holcomb Bridge.
Thank you. Okay, so for consensus, we'll get to it. I promise. Yeah, we'll get there. So just we have consensus among the panelists and City Council that we will get to the end of this line. So please, nobody else join the line. And next question, please.
You have to talk into the mic.
Yes, my name is Julie from Centennial. I'm going to try this well. One of the things is we pay tax dollars for MARTA, and we don't have MARTA in East Roswell. And that we drive a lot of traffic and economics to East Roswell. And my wife has friends that have cars, and if they come here with MARTA, they would come and visit periodically. So that's very important.
Is your question around are we going to work toward MARTA?
Why don't we have MARTA?
Thank you.
As a former transit manager for many years, perhaps I don't know what MARTA's position is, but it strikes me that one of the issues that comes up is density. You have to have enough people starting somewhere that are going to the same place. Otherwise, it's not economic to do it. It is a numbers game, and you're right. You pay taxes for it. What are you getting for it? Well, maybe you're getting the other people to ride it so that you have the roads to yourself. That's a thought. it comes up. But the point is, yeah, I know with the SPLOST, I'm not sure how that's being distributed exactly, because it seems to change a lot, but perhaps that's an opportunity there for some bus service. But running a bus, but you said something interesting, they want to come now and then and ride the bus. Well, that's not profitable for a company that's not making a profit already. So, you know, it's a tough sell to those people, and it's a tough sell to the transit professionals. And again, you don't want to waste your tax dollar on something that's empty all the time, because then in 2 years you're going to complain that there's no one on the buses.
Thank you very much. Next question, please.
My name is Laura Aldo. I live in Mayfair. My kids go to East Roswell Preschool. They're 3 and 1.
They're very cute.
Thank you. They are very cute. You know, I've heard a lot of people grumbling about apartments, and I think that's a main issue that we're missing here around the Target, is that there was a shooting there the other night. There's been shooting there multiple times. I've had police in my cul-de-sac searching for people behind my woods, and I had children. I don't want to get a gun, but I will get a gun because this neighborhood is not safe. And I think that is the big issue that people are missing, is that what are you gonna do about the safety around that Target area? People are vandalizing that Target. What is going to be done to ensure the safety of whatever businesses come into that complex to revitalize this? I don't want to leave Roswell, but I'm getting to the point where I have to think of my family and my safety, and I do not feel safe in this part of town anymore. So what is going to be done to ensure the safety of the families that want to stay here?
Thank you.
So yes, I mean, we have a few apartment complexes who has a problem of safety, and we are working now with the police to clean up, because you know the problem is not huge. It's just a small percent. It's a lot of people hard working on this apartment complex, and they have a decent life. They have kids. They have family. They are trying to be part of the community. So we're working with the police department to create a neighbor watch program that we all know in our nice affluent neighborhoods we have this, but with the police department in the past we never had the neighbor watch program into the apartment complex. So actually, a month ago, we have our first meeting of the apartment complex across the street from the Red Lobster, and people were so excited to see us implementing the Neighbor Watch program. When they see any bad movement in there, they will report to the police, and we will clean it up. I mean, and the thing is, the good news is like, that is new. We're not in New York, you know, when Giuliani cleaned it up. It's very small percentage inside this apartment complex who create the problem. So we're working with the police, we're working with the owners or the managers of the, they say, you know, they share information if someone have been already arrested, so then they're not able to get into any apartment complex. So we're working actively with the police to you know, make sure that we clean this small percentage. That is one issue. The other issue is, you know, I've been working, because it's a problem all around town, how to stabilize this apartment complex where, you know, you have, like I say, hard worker people, you know, decent or you know, mid, low income, but, you know, very productive for the community. So there is a program called C-Star that they start doing in Atlanta that is how they can stabilize those apartment complex. And the main problem is there, because then when, once you stabilize the apartment complex, not only the crime is low or zero, but also the schools. You start seeing the schools performing much, much better. So I've been in contact with the person in charge of this program, trying to get more information, trying to see how they can start looking into Roswell, because we have a lot of apartment complex, how they can start looking into Roswell to come and try to stabilize those apartment complex. So this is something I started around 2 months ago. So I'm working on that, and I'm gonna ask, you know, my council colleagues to support on this initiative, how we can bring this. So what they do is the main thing, they buy the complex and they secure the rent for 10 years. So then you eliminate, because when they can increasing the rent, you start having the turnover on the apartment complex. And this is what the problem starts. So what they people, what they do, they acquire and they stabilize for 10 years the rent, so they get the same people over and over, and they create the community inside the apartment complex, where they have after school programs inside the apartment complex. So we're working on that, and it's something that I just start working on.
That's awesome. Star C, I worked with them in the fall, and I'm here to tell you that they're in the process of trying to scale up. They've had it there in Clarkston predominantly right now, and they've been very successful. It would certainly be worth a conversation, but I know that it's not a foolproof plan, but they're struggling with how to grow in order to be in other, you know, to if you want to think of it, franchising. But the Star C model is a pretty effective one. It's certainly been shown. They went in Clarkston, they took they linked schools with these apartments, and they moved in, you know, it's like workforce housing, immigrant housing, recent immigrants. They provide, there's some social service provision in there, and they went from apartments that had, they were crime-ridden, scary places, to absolutely zero crime. The kids walked themselves to the school nearby, I mean, by themselves. Hello? I mean, so they're pretty effective.
Thank you.
My name is Michael Litton, and I'm a resident in Martin's Landing, and my question ties into my friend Phil Wall's comment, the owner of Kill Me Crazy. Why not a block party at Connection, embracing the genius of the and, a Live After Five and an East Roswell block party instead of the tyranny of the or? Show East Roswell a little bit of love.
Thank you. Is there a response? We go to the next question. Thank you.
I'm really short.
That was the question.
It was, well, why not do it?
Why not?
Okay, is there an answer?
I don't know. So, I moved here when Hope Bridge wasn't paved, March of 1973. I don't live around here. I live downtown Roswell in the historic district behind the Thousand Hills Coffee House. I know these things for sure, and then I'll ask my question.
Thank you very much.
A community is only as strong as its weakest link. The good news is Roswell won the geography lottery. We sit on the banks of a beautiful river. We have rolling hills. We have beautiful forests. The bad news is Roswell squandered its lottery winnings.
Let's try to stay.
I know.
Okay, thank you. Toward the future.
You asked about Marta, Dr. Thacker, or whatever your name is. I know more about Marta than you do. I can tell you that one of the problems with this part of Roswell, I haven't been to East Roswell, and I might as well pack a bag, is The city of Roswell is not connected. And by the way, people in East Roswell...
Before you get too much further, everybody, it's late for everybody.
I know. Well, I've been waiting too. It's late for all of us.
Yeah,
I'm the oldest person in the room. He says slack.
Please ask the question.
What I want to say is, Roswell has the opportunity to unite both sides of Roswell. East Roswell isn't the stepchild. My district's the stepchild. Everybody says their
district's
the stepchild.
Please, please get to the question.
I would like to know, first of all, I've been in touch with the C-STAR program as well. It works fabulous. I've been working with the police
department. Please get to the question.
If you would interrupt me, I would.
Just one question.
Okay. Has the city of Roswell considered, and I brought this up before, implementing an intra-city transit system so that we can get from one side of Roswell to the other without getting in our cars? Athens has it, College Park has it, why not Roswell?
Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, wait a second. Is there an answer to the intra-city?
How would
we know?
The answer is density.
Not about density.
There have been a lot of other issues that are about the docket, and that is an issue that's been discussed, but we've not had a work session on it, and it's something that we need to seriously consider. But we're talking about the T-SPLOST. The T-SPLOST that we just passed does not apply to a transit system. It applies to roads and bridges. And we're going to have the historic gateway that's on the board. That's going to be part of this T-SPLOST. We've got the Big Creek Parkway is another part of the T-SPLOST. Big Creek Parkway will take a lot of pressure off of Holcomb Bridge. That's a $55 million project. It's going to take a couple of years to get the design documents and all the approvals and land acquisition and that sort of thing. But in terms of having an intra-city transit system, that's something that we just have to discuss. And I will just say this, it takes money, right? So it takes money, and it takes money to operate. And those are some of the trade-offs we have to think about. How much are we willing to pay to have an intra-city system?
Let me also add here, and you may know more than me about MARTA, that's fine. I believe you. I mean, I'm not doubting you. I've helped set up these systems in New Jersey, and the first thing you find is that it's pretty cheap to buy a couple of buses. I mean, it's not cheap, but it's relatively cheap. But where they all go belly up is the operating costs. That is by far the greatest cost. And you get some seed money and you think that it's going to be great and it works very fine, but then you don't have the ridership to sustain it and you're stuck with buses that you end up selling to someone else. The kinds of work that you're talking about, I mean, you would have to run the numbers. I don't know that 70,000 people give you the kind of numbers. 97,000, you're in the same order of magnitude, but it would have to be studied because that's a pure numbers game there. What are you willing to pay for a bus? Is it free? Do you charge $10 a ride? You're not going to get federal subsidies for it, and you're not going to exist on handouts. So I think you have to be careful with that stuff because it is really expensive, and it's expensive in the short run, but it's really expensive in the long run if there's not the ridership.
Thank you very much.
And the ultimate question.
I have a question.
Okay, rule follower, go for it.
12-year resident of Horseshoe Bend.
So Mark, to your point, I know that there's a couple of instances with apartments and the violence, but when you hear that it's a homicide or a child bringing a loaded gun to school, it gets our attention. So the question I have, and I've been reading up on this, is there a way through a good neighbor law ordinance to cite and maybe fine some of these apartment owners for the violence that happens on their properties? That would be something the city or state could do that could before C-STAR. That sounds amazing. I love that idea. But in advance of that, is there a way to make them accountable for it in a way that could be consistent? Because these folks who live in these apartments, we need them. I get it. but they also deserve to be safe, and us surrounding neighbors deserve to be safe too. So is there a way to do that?
So I know part of the answer to your question. So to partly answer your question, I know for a fact there is liability when the family of a victim, then I forget if it's, there was actually an example with one of the hotels that was mentioned earlier. They actually end up having a very expensive, very temporary cleanup to stop the crime because they end up having a lot of liability because there was a lawsuit against the owner from that horrible tragedy. So that's something I've learned from the city attorney on a way that there can be that prosecution. But I don't know if anybody knows without the family prosecuting if there's any way to do that. Or is Kay Love still here? Are you familiar with any? I'll meet you in the middle.
Thanks. There are some ways. We do have some nuisance ordinances on the books. They're very specific about the violations, about the types of criminal activity. We are engaged in looking at that in particular areas, specifically on the east side. But it is very, very technical, and it's very difficult, but it is something that we're aware of, and we understand and share that same concern.
And it's a question I haven't heard tonight, and so I would like somebody to address this. I moved to Roswell over 20 years ago as well, and I moved to Roswell, and I had moved out, and I moved back to Roswell because specifically it is a bedroom community. I lived in Dunwoody, I lived in Alpharetta, I moved to Roswell because Roswell is where I wanted to live because it doesn't have the huge densities, the huge big boxes. I can go to Alpharetta for that. I can go to Dunwoody for that. I moved here because of we are a bedroom community. And my question is, why is that such a bad thing? Why is it always so much more development that has to be done? Why can't we keep that character of Roswell?
I actually think we can. And I'll tell you why we can't. We've got to decide in this room amongst the property owners that own the homes in this room to have consensus. What do we want? Do we want to be that? That's fine. Then we have to be prepared with what we have to do with that. Now, I'm going to answer one question that kind of ties into your comment about the apartments. When I moved to Roswell in 1976, we didn't have a chance to build the house on Tyson's Corners because it wasn't ready. It was going to take 9 months. My parents moved us to Grand Creek Apartments, which is now Aspen. It was made, they were constructed in 1969. Those are highly profitable apartments owned by highly profitable companies. And they're 40 plus years old. The rent rates were third or fourth in the metro Atlanta area. They're not owned by slumlords. So we have to decide about what that looks like to help redevelop that northwest quadrant and redevelop some of those so that the word density becomes, instead of a large patio garden style apartment, that it's condensed. And then people can live there safely. So I think it's important to remember that we all have had a chance. I would love for my daughter, who's 21, to come home from the University of Georgia and move to Roswell. Go Dogs. No offense. But at the end of the day, she can't afford CityWalk, even if she gets a job at Jackson Healthcare that announced 1,400 jobs in Alpharetta last week. She cannot afford CityWalk. But I don't want her living in some of these other neighborhoods because it is a very small group that makes it unsafe. So we need to figure out how to get to the root of that problem. And that, again, takes consensus. People living in apartments, it's not a bad word, Folks, I grew up in one. Before my parents owned the one in Tyson Circle. So at the end of the day, we don't all come from the same silver spoons. We all didn't immigrate in here with IBM with a large bonus check. But we also now have, we're asking for service industry, service-driven jobs to come back into Roswell. We gotta have a place for them to live. So we need to look at what that looks like. So that is a huge emotional question. That doesn't mean that it has to go where the target is. It means we have to look at it in the entire Roswell area and what that looks like.
Thank you, Steve. And thank you, everyone, for coming out this evening. My comments will be at an end right now. What we're going to do at this point is have one final comment by each of the panelists. Thank you, everyone, for attending. Thank you, panelists. And then we can go to our councilman to finish up for the evening. Dr. McNair, if you would get us started, that would be great.
I just want to keep it short. I would love to have more conversations with as many of you as we can. I think that's the way that we go forward, is we have conversations, we try to get something really moving. Whether those are work sessions or whether those are happening outside, please, let's talk.
Thank you. Everybody have a good night.
I'm repeating myself, but there are costs and benefits, and I think we've talked about that a bunch, that if you want one thing, it's going to cost something. If you want something else, there's going to be a cost. You're just going to have to decide how you balance those out. And I think we've heard some of the issues that are weighing, housing, talked about transportation, talked about business development, but all those things, none of it's free. Again, none of it's free. And so you're going to have to decide how you want to spend your money.
I think I heard it in the audience, it might have been Jay, just said, it's dialogue, it's conversation. We need to continue these conversations so that we continue as a community to say what it is we want. And again, it's not a silver, there's no silver bullet. If there was a silver bullet, we'd have had it taken care of. Somebody would have. But keep the dialogue going.
Thank you, Steve. So last things I want to say is, in the 14 months I've served as a council member, I've learned the squeaky wheel gets the grease. So you need to continue really pushing what you want, really reminding your elected officials and different stakeholders, because you have a voice and you can really have a say. As we discussed, you have a chance to say really what Roswell should be. And I love today that there were a lot of creative ideas, whether it be makerspace, whether it be, again, I've mentioned music venue or other opportunities on how we can really get this to be a destination and really the community we want it to be. So thank you everybody for coming tonight. Ms. Councilmember Horton?
When I served on the Georgia Initiative for Community Housing, we found two very important facts about the city of Roswell. It's kind of a dichotomy. 85% of the people that live in Roswell do not work in Roswell. 85% of the people that work in Roswell do not live in Roswell. So it's a horrible situation, because it's an economic drain on the entire community. The people who live in Roswell and commute out, that creates traffic problems. And it's the traffic problems that you're feeling every day. But the people who live outside of Roswell that work in Roswell, that also creates traffic problems, all right? So that's the dichotomy that we have. And what we have to understand is that somewhere along the line, we have to create what is called workforce housing. Housing that people who work in Roswell can't afford to live in. If we don't do that, just keep this in mind, they are going home at night outside of Roswell, they're spending their paychecks, they're paying their rent or their house payment, they're buying their cars and their clothes and everything else. It's an economic drain on Roswell, a significant economic drain. So we have to start
there either.
Pardon?
How is that different from Dunwoody or Alpharetta or any place that can't afford that either? And how does Roswell compare with that 85% shift that you're saying to the other areas around it? I think everybody's community.
Alpharetta has a lot of grade A office. Mm-hmm. So Alpharetta has a lot of office jobs where the people are working in Alpharetta and living in
Alpharetta. And
we really lack a lot of grade A office. So
it's the office space that probably that we need more than anything, we've got to find a way to attract office, and maybe that's that hotel type of office where you have 15 or 20 offices and a central secretary that maybe your assistant that is answering the phones for people and so on. So that's the kind of thing that we need to look at. But we also need to think about what can we do to create housing that people who work in Roswell can afford to live in. And that's what we call workforce housing. That's healthcare workers, teachers, police officers,
city employees,
people who work here.
Thank you. So, well, just, wrapping this up, I would say that definitely we have a deficit of office, but you know what? Now it's an opportunity. It's a great opportunity because the concept of offices is changing. The tall Empire State Building, enclosed office where the boss never get out and talk to anybody, those days are gone. So what is now going on is the open space where you can interact with everybody. And now, nothing better than a super target to get it into an office with the new concept of open space. So the Empire State Building office concept is yesterday. So that is a good thing for us, that we have a lot of spaces that we can work into office now, that we shouldn't be missing this train, because we're lucky that the concept of office is changing. And now we have a lot of space of the traditional big box retail that they're leaving behind, that we can definitely convert those into the new office space for innovation, for millennials, for startups, for incubators, and for people who just, instead of going to a coffee shop, just can go and work for 2, 3, 4 hours in a new office concept. So I see this as a great opportunity and to jump into the office, and we do need office space. So the other thing we need is more destination place. We have a beautiful Canton Street. We all love Canton Street. Great job they have done there, but it's not enough. We need to create more destination places. I don't know, I'm always trying to put the bar, higher and higher on myself. So I think that we should create more destination, and now East Roswell is a great opportunity to create our own destination place here in East Roswell. So I appreciate all your coming here today, all your comments, involvement, and I will definitely want to thanks a lot our Mr. Levin, our moderator. He did a great job. I know it's not an easy task, so please. So Steve Stroud, thank you very much for coming today. I appreciate it. Mr. Hacker, thank you so much for coming. Paul, appreciate it. Dr. McNeil, thank you so much for coming. So please be proud. We are going to do it again. So stay tuned, because this is just the beginning. It's not the end. We have a long way to go. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm going to interrupt. Thank you. I'm going to interrupt. Thank you.